Good morning. Let's stand together and let's worship the Lord together this morning.
Ask the Lord to come now like never before in your own words. Every breath that I Hallelujah. Come on, say thank you, Jesus. So very good to each, to every one of us. He loves us. He's on our side. He's freed us. He set us on a course of victory. He has covered us under the blood, and he has made us sons and daughters of the Most High God. If we have declared Jesus Savior and Lord, if Jesus is Savior and Lord, lift up both hands and say, Jesus, thank you. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for washing me in your precious blood. On this July 4th, it goes beyond the national freedom and national declaration of independence. It goes to the people of God, children of the Most High God, declaring that they are free from sin, free from its bondage. And we have been made more and more like Jesus Christ. I want to read out of Romans as the ushers begin to just pass out the emblems to each and every one that are followers of Jesus. Those of you that are at home, if you would, I would ask you to get some emblems and get ready to prepare to join in with us. The Bible says, Romans 6, what then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey, whether you're slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you wholeheartedly obeyed the form of teaching to which you were entrusted. Here's verse 18. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. That's who we are when we declare Jesus as our Savior, Lord, Master, and Redeemer. So you've got the cups, and I want you to go ahead and take that top layer off. It's a little bit of a task if you're new with us. Today, it's been a little easier. Thank you, Lord. That was simple. Some of you, if you're still struggling, I'll wait. But you've got that wafer, and I just want you to take it up, just break it in two, and just understand that Jesus's body was broken for you, bruised for you. He went to the cross for you. He died for you so that you and I could live. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the body of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Today, we celebrate freedom. Today, we celebrate wholeness. Today, we celebrate life that Jesus has given to us. We are new creations. We have been made clear anew in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we, Lord, become slaves, slaves to righteousness, slaves to God. We commit ourselves to you, giving you thanksgiving and praise. In Jesus' name, eat all of it today. Hallelujah. Then that next flap is also a flap. Hopefully you at home don't have to deal with all these little tasks, and maybe you just have a cup of juice or whatever you do have. But if you can, just pull that back. And as you do, let's prepare to receive this morning, Pastor Josh.
Let's go ahead and hold that cup up.
Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this cup. Lord, we thank you for what it represents. Lord, we thank you for that blood that flowed from that cross that day. Jesus. Heavenly Father, it's that blood, Lord, that washes away our sins. It's
thank
that
you,
blood
Lord.
That gets us new. Lord, it's you and your will, Lord, that we want
Hallelujah.
To do. Lord, it's you that
yes.
we want to be with. Heavenly Father, it's you
yes.
that this is all about.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for this, Lord. Lord, let this be a moment where we can look back and, Lord, look forward with courage to share our testimony, share our lives with those around us. In Jesus' name, let's drink together.
Amen. Hallelujah. 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 I just want everybody to say, Jesus. Everybody together say, Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. I pledge to live my life for you. In your name, amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord this morning. Thank you, Jesus.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God. The Lord is so good. We thank you, Father, for your mighty presence in this place this morning. God, we come to worship you, to listen to you, to look for you, Lord. And we call upon you on behalf of our precious members of this church, precious people. Father, we pray for those that have lost loved ones for this past few days. God, we just pray for your comforting Holy Spirit, that it will comfort them, bless them in this precious time, we pray. Father, we pray for Anita Cheatham this morning, looking to you on her behalf because there's been progress there, Father, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Father, for every little bit that you do. The big things, the little things, Father, we're seeking you. We're listening for you. We want to hear you speak, Father, and we also pray for Todd Mitchell, stage 3 cancer disease, Father. There's nothing too hard for you. Nothing, Lord. Nothing too hard for you. God, and we just present to you, we bring to our brother Mitchell, Father, to you, and we ask you, Father, to have your way in his life as we seek you for him. Father, and we pray also for New Life Assembly of God Church in McLeansburg, Illinois, Pastor Andy May. Oh, Father, may it be a lighthouse for you in that community. Lead, direct, and guide, I pray, by your Holy Spirit, so that your will be done, Lord. That is what we seek today. That is what we want. Nothing more, Lord, just more of you. Father, we pray for our missionary, Susan Clift, in Northern Asia. Dear God, we need you. We can't do this on our own. But Father, with you, all things are possible. Thank you so much, Father. We love you this morning. Thank you for sending our worship leader our way. Thank you so much for her spirit. God, and we just ask for you to bless this church. Be with us, Father. May we be that lighthouse, Father, for others to see. Bless our pastor as he brings forth the word this morning, I pray. May your word go forth and find good ground. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Everybody said. God bless you. You may be seated. Good to see all of you on July 4th weekend, to be in God's house and to be with God's people and to lift up Jesus Christ is a joy and it is a delight. Next in our service, we want to be very faithful with the first fruits. That is our offerings. That is our first of the first as we bring it to the Lord on the day. That is his day, the Sabbath day, and it represents something very, very holy and very special. And so I just want to pray blessings on you as you give and however you give. I just want to say thank you. Just be faithful to the Lord, faithful to his church, and he will just honor and reward you. Let's bow our hearts together. Father, thank you for the Spirit of the Lord that is here in this place today, this Spirit of life and freedom, the Spirit of joy and happiness. And Lord, we just look to you for everything. We've prayed. Lord, we praise. Now we get to give. You give us the joy of giving. And Lord, just let us open up our hearts to bring the tithe and the offering, the first fruits as it's seen, Lord Jesus, to represent, Lord, the first of the harvest that belongs to you. And so, Lord, just bless the action, Lord. Bless that which prompts us to move forward in obedience. And then, Lord, just rain down upon us with your overflow blessings. Meet every need, we ask in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. God bless you as you give.
Are you, Lord?
Sing with me, all the earth. Lord is so good to us. He's so great. We have so many reasons to thank him, to praise him, to give him every song that we sing, every breath that we breathe. Lord, just we thank you right now, God. We praise your name. Jesus, we love you. We love you, Lord. Amen, amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Everybody stand up. Would you do that real quick? Just stand up. I got 90 seconds to just offer you the chance to say hello and greet somebody in your neck of the woods. So if you would, you go ahead and turn around, make somebody feel welcome. 90 seconds, and then we'll be back. Those of you at home, you might want to take a restroom break or a coffee break. Thank you, Pastor. Seconds. Hi, Scott. Ten seconds. Praise God. God bless you. So good to share amongst family members and the body of Christ. It's something special to be together in the house of the Lord. And you are here today. The Lord is here today. And the Holy Spirit is here. Can somebody say amen? The Holy Spirit of God is with us, third person of the Trinity. And we'll be talking in part seven in just a moment about that. I do want to share as just a look across the congregation, just my heart for members of our church that have gone through just difficult moments of the passing of loved ones, for Renee Guiano and his family, the passing of his father. Our prayers, our love have been with you, Renee, and I hope that you have sensed and felt just that prayer support as well. For Teresa Sipos and her family, the passing of her mother, and others that are either in the hospital or facing just difficult decisions and you know, things that they have gone through in meeting with doctors and diagnoses and other things. But we know that the Lord is faithful, and our trust and our hope is in him. As I look across, I see the Mariani family here with us today, and it's good to have them back. Ron, Leslie, worshiped with us for several years, and their story and their testimony just rings true, Ron, of what I just can't forget, the power of God and the protection of God, and that'll go with you wherever. But as well, for Leslie, I believe retirement is now in, so let's thank her for so many years of service to our country, serving in the Air Force, and we are just delighted to have you to see you today in service. Just want to mention, as our leadership has gone through new kind of the COVID protocols, we sent that out to you. We printed them up for you. And some of you are saying, but why is that really so needed when we've reached really that the governor's number five phase? Well, there's still stuff out there. And I will mention that even in district council of 1 month ago, there was an outbreak of about 10 to 20 people that were impacted and affected with COVID. There's new Delta variant and virus. And so we want to keep you guys safe, and we want to keep doing what we feel is best. We've made some changes and kind of loosened up in certain areas. So if you would just honor that for all of us as we move forward and continue to just serve the Lord
Jesus Christ. All right, Joy Ministry event. They have their monthly event this coming Friday night. If you haven't signed up, you might want to do so to get in on the list and let our leaders know that you are coming. VBS is fast approaching. We've got one month, and we are having Vacation Bible School. And Pastor Ashland and Tammy are getting things all set up, but they're needing a few extra hands. Well, maybe a little bit more than a few extra hands to make things work. As you know, there's a lot of work that goes in behind the scenes and putting our pending all the backdrops and the pictures and to trace out, to draw, to paint, to just get things ready. If you could see either one of those ladies, Pastor Ashland or Tammy, work has already begun. Marion's already jumped in and gotten things going. It's looking great, but man, we need a lot more hands, a lot more helpers, and we're looking forward to an incredible outreach in the month of August. And then also, you've got your notes through YouVersion Bible app. You might want to tap into that right now and turn to Ephesians chapter 1. And we're going to look at part 7 in a series. But before we do that, I'm going to ask Pastor Lexi to come here to the platform. I want to ask Ron and Jean if you would come here as well. This is her first Sunday with us, and as you know, just many weeks ago, she came, was with her fiancé. Come up here on the platform. I think we need to pray for Pastor Lexi as she starts her ministry here amongst us. How many are glad that the Lord sent her here to us? Come on, let's give her a warm welcome. If you would come right here, and I just want to lay our hands, my deacons, and all of you, would you just stretch forth your hand, and we're going to pray blessing and favor. Mom, if you're watching, or Dad, or Chad, you stretch forth your prayers and your faith, and we know that God is going to do an incredible work through this servant that the Lord is going to use right here in leading worship ministries. Men, let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the gifts that you give to the church. Lord, we know that you bring servants and you bring, Lord, sons and daughters, and you bring those that are called by you. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Lexi and, Lord, her heart that is so tender to the things of God. Lord, as she has prepared herself, Lord, as she has readied herself for this moment, she's so excited, Lord. She's ready to go and serve you. But, Lord, we just pray that you would cloak her, Lord, with a double portion of your spirit and, Lord, empowerment. Lord, give her everything that she needs to lead, Lord, worship and fine arts and the ministry, Lord, that she'll oversee. I pray that you would bless her abundantly. I pray that you give her strength and protection, Lord, from this moment on. May she see a marked change, and may we all feel, Lord, that powerful surge of your presence, Lord, flow into every service as she, Lord, uses her gifts, talents, and abilities. We commit her to you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. We love you. Give her one more hand, okay? God bless you, Pastor Lexi. Amen. Pray for Mom and Dad, too. They had to leave her on Friday. And you know, Mom and Dad, when you leave your kids off to school or college, or if you see them go off and serve, there is just something about leaving your baby or leaving one of your kids, and that's what Mom and Dad. I got to meet them, and it was a joy to meet Richard and Terry and Casey and the family. So we're just delighted to have her here. All right. Ephesians chapter 1, we're going to get right into seventh part. Somebody said it might go on. I said, well, right now this is the ending, but we'll see what God has. I thought last week literally was, and I was going through and looking. The Holy Spirit laid this particular item of his service, work, and ministry, and so I don't want to overlook what he's going to share with us today about what he does. Now, remember, the Holy Spirit is not just a force. It's not an it. It's not an afterthought. The Holy Spirit is a person with feelings. He can be grieved. He has He has responsibilities and delegations, and he is working in tandem, in synergy with God the Father and God the Son, Jesus Christ. And so we've been looking 7 weeks, six weeks thus far. I want to take you through if it'll remind you, if you've been with us. If you haven't, you can find these on our website or YouTube, and all of these messages are in this series. But first of all, we looked at the convictor. The Holy Spirit is the convictor. Secondly, he's the empowerer, fills us with power. He's the indweller. He lives with us, goes with us. He's the guide. He leads, guides. He's our sanctifier, cleansing and purifying, our teacher. This is what we looked at last week. He reveals, illuminates, and explains. And then today we come to Ephesians chapter 1, which will be our text. And then, of course, many other verses. We find that the Holy Spirit is a seal. Now, all of us have different perspectives and thoughts and maybe ideas of what a seal is. For those of you that can, do we have any canners in the house? All right, you can and you put vegetables or sauce and you put it in that jar and then you seal it up. Some of you might think of the seal like that. And that's not really what we're looking at today. We're going to open up from the scripture the perspective of the work of the Holy Spirit in sealing, the seal in our life. What does that mean? Well, there's a passage in Ephesians, and it's chapter 1, and it simply is from 11 to 14. And I love it when we give honor and respect to God's word. So stand with me quickly. Let's read these couple of verses and pray and dive into part number 7. Ephesians 1 verse 11 says, "In him we were chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who was a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who were God's possession to the praise of his glory." Father, thank you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Help us to understand your work function and your work role in sealing us, placing your seal on our lives and in our hearts. Help us to be, Lord, just opened up in the fullness of understanding and the depth of what this means for every child of God. Lord, just bless your people, bless your children, help them to grow in relationship and fellowship with the Holy Spirit. We give you thanks in Jesus' name, and everyone said amen. God bless you. You may be seated. All right. So part number 7, seal. Seal of the Holy Spirit and the work that he has in our lives. There's some things that really need to be understood. And so let's look at it from verse number 13. Everybody jot down some of these thoughts and notes. And with YouVersion, you can even add to what is listed there by adding some of your own notes. So number one is the mark. The Holy Spirit works, serves as a seal. Which, what does that mean? It means that there is the mark of God's ownership. God's ownership. So the Living Bible would say, verse 13, like this, "And because of what Christ did, all you others too, who heard the good news about how to be saved and trusted Christ, were marked as belonging to Christ by the Holy Spirit, who long ago had been promised to all of us Christians." We've been marked as belonging to Christ. This seal is the literal mark of God's ownership. Thinking back to biblical times, we must understand that a seal was used in the manner, perhaps, of what we could see as a signature today, to denote ownership, to denote responsibility, signatures on documents, letters, contracts. There is this that denotes it came and it marks who that belongs to. Things have changed in the days long past from when you had to sign documents forever. Now, they want you to sign electronically online through one of the services, through like DocuSign or others. But when you put your name, your signature, your mark, it signifies, as we now see, the seal of the Holy Spirit. It validates this mark that we belong to God. The seal of the Spirit is on our life. Something that we must understand about this seal, never forget that the seal didn't cause ownership. All right, the seal didn't cause it, only recognized ownership. What does that mean? Simply means that we have become born again and saved by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the true purchase price. He shed his blood on Calvary and he has set us free. We become children of the King. But we got to understand about the seal. It recognizes whose hand of ownership is there in the life, and that's what the seal of the Spirit represents. Indicates that we've been delivered from the power of sin and darkness and been transferred into the kingdom of God's dear Son. The seal symbolizes, listen to this, a crossover. You've crossed over from death, and now what do you have? You've been crossed over into life and sealed by the Spirit, belonging to God, sealed by the Spirit, saved and rejoicing. This is the seal that really indicates that we have been blood bought and that we are in the kingdom of God and that we are closer to the Son of the Most High God and being brought into fellowship with the Father. Colossians 1. Let me share a couple of truths out of Colossians 1, 13 and 14. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. This crossover, all right, from what we were now to who we are. This crossover, and then we have been marked and sealed by the Holy Spirit. Beautiful symbolism, beautiful understanding of what the working of the Spirit is providing for us. Another picture for us to understand in the New Testament about this seal has this idea of the designation of ownership, perhaps a trademark indicating that we are his workmanship. A seal that we are his workmanship. You have artists, and in the bottom of the picture, they'll do their what? They're sometimes initials, sometimes it's their marking, sometimes it's their name, signifying, well, that's a Picasso, or that's a whatever those beautiful, most special drawings are. There is that signature trademark of ownership. Ephesians 2:10 would say this, for we are God's workmanship. Think about it. Created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. We are God's workmanship, and all of you have a seal of the Spirit that has been etched into your heart and life, a trademark signifying you belong to Him, property of the Most High God. Now, for us to understand it in our day, I'm going to show you a few trademark logo pictures and see if you might identify who these are. They're pretty well recognizable. And if you don't know them, then maybe, wow, I don't know how you've missed them. But let's look at them together. The first one has the name, and we should have taken the name out. But if I just left the swoop, how many would be able to recognize that is Amazon, all right? You see their trucks all over the place, blue trucks with that. And we can see it like that. The second one, anybody know what this is? Apple. Next one. You see, you guys are right on top. A little bit different than Amazon, but you look at it and you say, no, that's Nike. I like Nike, all right? My daughter likes Adidas. That's okay. She's got her own trademark, and I've got mine. How about the next one? Anybody been here? Man, you guys are quick. It's recognizable. It's something that you know. The next one is? And they are the Golden Arches. Yeah, you just have to see that symbol, and you're on the highway, and you see that little insignia logo on the side of the road. Well, you're looking for that. If you're searching for a McDonald's, just look for the Golden Arches. And then lastly, I'm going to ask Pastor Lexi, does she know what this is? Starbucks. That's where she was working in the interim between school and now here. Starbucks. And I could go on and on in others. The AT&T symbol logo. Disney. Woo. Facebook. Pepsi. Coke. Volkswagen. OAG even has our own identity and our own trademark. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21 and 22. Write it down, but let's read it together as we look at this mark, the seal that God places on us as His own. Now, it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us. Can you say amen to that? He set His seal of ownership on us. What does that seal look like? Well, I guess we won't know until we get to heaven what that seal might be, a blood mark, the cross, the picture of Christ, whatever that is. It's the seal of His ownership on us, and put His Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. First of all, about this seal and the work that He does is He marks us as belonging to Him. And how many believes that those that have been saved and set free can even be witnessed by other believers? How many knows there is that joy and there's that life and there is that look and there is that lifestyle and characteristic, the seal that is misunderstood. Many times you'll be someplace and you say, that person's got to be a believer. That person's got to be a Christian. Look at their heart. Look at their life. Look at how they even bow their heads and pray out in public. Wow. There are things that you can see and know, but the seal of the Spirit is the marking of God's ownership. Verse 14 in our text is the second one, and I want you to see that it always talks about what is to come. So, secondly, it's the first installment of the Christian's inheritance. First being the operative because it's the first of others. More to come. Verse 14 says it like this. You were marked in Him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of His glory. Think of it this way. The seal of the Holy Spirit is this installment or this deposit, some could say, of what is to come. It's a guarantee that there's much more in greater measure that is going to be inputted and downloaded into your life. It's also, yes, futuristic, the inheritance that we have, eternal inheritance. But we also see that here and now, it's the first of more, the first of many that God would want to bless us with. It speaks to what we have now, yes, what we've received through the Spirit's seal, but it's also a guarantee there's greater fullness to come, so much more. Anybody heard the phrase, the best is yet to come? This could be said of the seal in your life. The best is yet to come. The Spirit was there when you crossed over from death to life. In fact, the Holy Spirit was drawing you to Jesus, allowing you to feel the love of God and to show you and to convict you of sin in your heart and life and how desperately you needed to be saved and forgiven and set free. The Spirit was there at that work and in that ministry. But even in the midst of all of that transaction, moving from death and decay to life and happiness in Jesus, we will see that it is only the beginning. It's this actual start, if you will, the Holy Spirit who seals us. And we can even say that the Holy Spirit is our earnest. Some of you might understand what that earnest is. The earnest of, as you look at a financial transaction and you understand earnest money is required, had to be brought to the table. If you have a housing transaction, a property transaction, a car, anything like that, the earnest is something that is laid down from the buyer to the seller in order to legally bind that contract. The Holy Spirit is present, the seal. He's there at the binding of somebody's heart to the heart of Jesus Christ. And it's simply that down payment, that deposit, which symbolizes there's so much, much more. We received the Holy Spirit when we were born again. How many will say amen to that? You couldn't have been saved without His working. But can I tell you, there is so much more. So much more in the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Another experience that every child of God is encouraged to experience and to have. More of the power, more of the fruits of the Spirit to be full operating in our lives. More of the spiritual gifts and spiritual treasures that the Spirit gives to understand them. Just think about the seal as a first installment of so much more to happen in your life here and in the life to come, in the inheritance that we have received because we are children of the Lord. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 5. Listen to this verse about this thought. Now it is God who has made us for this very purpose and has given us the Spirit as a deposit. There's that seal. There's that thought guaranteeing what is to come. We've been saved by the blood of the Lamb, sealed by the Holy Spirit, guaranteeing us of a front row seat in heaven. How many wants a front row seat in heaven? Put your hands up. How many wants to be in the very, very back? Put your hand up. You better not. I was coming home yesterday from the office, and it wasn't sunset yet, but I saw a whole lot of people gathering, bringing their chairs. I mean, it was still early. Sun hadn't even set. What is going on here? I mean, people in businesses off the road, people in the park area. Oh, the fireworks is happening tonight. And I just kept going, driving through, seeing pockets of people, seeing ticker tape. You can't park here. You can't be there. Going a little farther, I saw former members of our church, and I waved at them as they were in a roundabout circle. And I'm like, they have their own seat looking to the fireworks. People that really want to have a good spot and a good seat. Think about believers in Jesus getting the best seat in heaven because the seal of the Spirit is giving us His seal signature move in our lives that there is still yet so much more and we will be there in heaven because of what Christ and the Spirit has done in our lives. Now understand this thought about sealing, kind of maybe protecting and guarding that which we've committed unto him. But can I also tell you this? It doesn't mean that you cannot lose your salvation. Some people think, I've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. I'm good to go. I can do whatever I want, go wherever I want, drink whatever I want, watch whatever I want, listen, all of those things, and I have been sealed by the Spirit. Nothing's going to change my destiny. No, you still have to have the maintenance of operative, faithful faith in your heart and life. If you agree with that, say amen. Faith is maintained. It's not just an automatic seal and check, this one's just being pushed on through and heaven to come. No, we still need to live it out. We still need the life and power and anointing of the Holy Spirit day in and day out, moment in and moment out. But when we look at this seal and this installment, it shows there is so much more in the inheritance that we have through Christ. Number three, we go to a different passage of Scripture. I want to take you to Romans chapter 8. Turn over to Romans 8. And this third thought, this third point of the seal of the Spirit is there is evidence with the seal of the Spirit that assurance has been granted for those that are children of God. The evidence of assurance as a child of God points to this seal, all right? The seal, the trademark, the down payment, the deposit, the earnest, all of that, it points to who we are in Christ. There is this assurance. Does anybody need assurance? Let me hear an amen. Assurance is crucial. Assurance and certainty that we are in, that we are obedient, that we are faithfully following the Lord and His will. It's a mark of recognition that we are sons and daughters of God. Romans 8, now let's listen to what it says in verse 13. For if you live according to the sinful nature, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Because those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. We've looked at this verse earlier in the series. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the Spirit of sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. That's the working of the seal going on. Testifies, reminds us, hello, you're my kids. Hello, I love you. Hello, I've got great plans for you. Hello, don't forget to spend those quality moments with me. He reminds us, he's with us. He tells us that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we're heirs. What does an heir represent? That you are heir to an inheritance. Heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we also share in his glory. We see that this evidence of the mark then gives us that symbolization of certainty and confidence that we are the children of God, sons and daughters. God's working in us. God's living in us. His word is moving powerfully. His spirit is convicting and charging and empowering our lives. He's testifying, hello, you got to just stay with it. I'm on your side. You're with me. And he's constantly doing the work of telling you, you are in the camp of the redeemed. We all need that confidence. We all need that assurance. And that's the working of the Spirit doing that, reminding us. Now, here's another thought. Please listen. Listen to this. This does not mean that the sealed Christian is necessarily a perfect Christian. No, We're not perfect. He's still working on me, okay? But his or her sealing identifies him with a perfect Savior and a perfect salvation. Somebody say amen to that. A perfect Savior and a perfect salvation. We are connected to him. We are still a work in progress. Turn to your neighbor and say, you ain't finished yet, all right? Turn to your neighbor. Give him a big smile. Say, you ain't finished just yet. Those of you online, I love you, but you're not all there just yet, okay? Hang on. God's still doing a work on you. He's still shaping you, molding you, putting his imprint upon you, his insignia, his mark of ownership, but he is still having much to do with our lives. It guarantees security, guarantees assurance as far as God is concerned, and that's what you need to know. 2 Timothy 2:19. See how this connects. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription. How many wants to be sealed with the Holy Spirit and the inscription that says, the Lord knows those who are his? Hello? The Lord knows. He knows those who are his. He can see the seal. We might try. There might be people who try to just manufacture a seal, try to put on a show. But the Lord knows those who are his. Everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must do what? Turn away from wickedness. The seal symbolizes property, symbolizes installment, symbolizes confidence. Here's another thought in this third area is it's a way that we can see the squeeze, if you will, of God and the Holy Spirit on our lives. I want to show you a picture, and some of you will recognize what this tool is. Others of you are going to scratch your heads, look at your mom and dad or your kids and say, what in the world is that? How many knows what that is? Put your hands up. You know what that is. How many has ever used one of those? Put your hands up, all right? How many has the authority as a notary public? Any of those of you in the house? Wow, we have a notary public. So there you go. Ellen, if we need some help, we can go to you. Now, that little machine is an embosser. All right? It squeezes a piece of paper. You put the embosser, you squeeze that, and you'll get a seal with the name of the person, Ellen Gentry, who will have no doubt a number, and where she's authorized to sign, seal, and emboss or notarize that document. All of us have had to find a notary public in order for us to get our documents signed. I want you to think of the Spirit in regards to the seal that he has in our life, with the embosser forming a distinct and necessary impression on our hearts and lives. The work of the Spirit's forming within you and me and every child of God, the very nature, heartbeat, character, sweetness, power, presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in us. The Holy Spirit is giving us confidence, and he's also giving us his impression working in us. Galatians 4:19 says this little phrase, until Christ is formed in you. Until Christ, the seal of the Holy Spirit. Hello? I know you think you've come a long way, baby, and I know you have, but you've still got a ways to go. We still have to go on in the journey, learn and grow and become more and more made into the image of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Less like the attitudes of this world and more the attitude of heaven. Less of all the pettiness of this world and more about the purity and the wonder and the priority of heaven. The seal provides us with assurance that we are God's kids, and that he is impressing us to take on the character and the heart. And there is something that's going to be left once we're embossed by the Spirit.
You'll have that marking. You'll have that likeness planted there. Ephesians 4, verse number 30. And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. We can grieve the Spirit, the choices that we make with the seal. He is urging us. He is reminding us. He is fashioning us. He is embossing us with the image, the reflection, the trademark of Jesus Christ. We belong to Him. We're God's property and possession. There's so much more. The best is yet to come. The seal is a first installment of our inheritance in Christ. And we are assured with confidence, assured that we are the children of God. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes as you think about the working of the Holy Spirit in your life, the seal of the Holy Spirit? If you have crossed over from death to life, from sin over into salvation, then the seal is present in your heart and in your life. It's necessary. It's needed. Satan looks at that seal and he is not happy about whose mark is on your life. You need the seal of the Spirit. You need the trademark. You need that there. You need to be reminded that He is with you and He is urging you on to live a life of holiness, a life where the righteousness of God shines through. There has to be the clear definition of His Spirit, the Holy Spirit's seal in your life. And that's something that only He can give and He can grant to you. I want everybody to place your hands just on your hearts today. And today, in this service, and maybe somebody watching online, I don't want to close the service without giving you a chance to give your life to Jesus. Maybe you haven't crossed over the divide yet. Maybe you're still living in the world. Maybe you're still stuck in things that you know will not glorify and honor God, and you haven't committed your heart to Jesus. It's time for you to move on over and give it all to Jesus. No halfway, no partial, but just give everything to Jesus Christ. There's someone here today that wants to be saved, forgiven, and set free by the wonderful, precious blood of the Lamb of God. Just lift up that hand, and I'll look around, and I'll recognize that your desire today is to receive Christ, to be born again, to have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So now we're going to pray. All of us and those of you at home with your hands on your hearts, and let's all join together. Father, I thank You for this service today and all that You have done in our lives. Lord, we're going to just give ourselves to You, the continual working ministry of the Holy Spirit. We don't want to work against, we want to work with the Holy Spirit and what He's endeavoring to do and all of His many tasks and measures that we have learned, and there are still yet so many more. But Father, I pray regarding this seal that every one of us here today before we leave is assured of the trademark of heaven, the seal of the Spirit, the marking that we truly don't belong to this world. We have no part of this world. This world's passing away. But we'll have clearance and even a front row seat in heaven when Jesus comes back to take His church and His children home. Father, help us to understand. Help us to grasp, help us to appreciate what the Spirit is doing and has done in all of our lives once we said, I do, to Jesus. Help us to live holy, pleasing, lives that bring glory and honor to Jesus. Help us to be reminded and assured of this awesome seal. We're property of the Lord, and there is still so much more to come. The best is ahead of us. And so, Lord, continue to emboss our heart. Make it a clearer distinction on the fabric of our spiritual life. May others see and others know there's just something different. Even though they can't see the embossed seal, they're going to know there's something holy, beautiful, precious, clean, pure, and right that's going on in our lives. And Holy Spirit, we just want to thank you for your work, all that you do in the lives of people, individuals just like us, all around this world. We commit ourselves, we yield ourselves, we lean into the wind of the Spirit and all that he does, as we give you thanks and as we give you praise. Have your way in our lives, we pray. In Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Here's I want to end this service and the series. It's for us to move out. And I know we can't all get around the altar, but I know we can get a lot of us here. We're going to go like we did on Father's Day. We're going to stretch out from the flag all the way across to the other flag. Some of you will just want to get in the aisle, but I want you to move out, and I want you to say, I want to have the clear seal of the Spirit on my life. And I want others to see and know, and I just want to be blessed as he once again fashions the embossed seal of God's Holy Spirit. Would you stand up all over this place? Leaders, if you'd lead others. Moms and dads, if you'd lead fam, just lead to the altar and say, here I am, Lord. Here I am, Holy Spirit, to have your way inside of us for your glory, for your honor, so the world can see, so the people can know we've been marked and sealed and kept by the power of God. Come on, begin to move as we begin to worship the Lord. Just lift up those hands and thank him for all that the Spirit is doing in your life. Come on, lift it up. Let's worship the Lord. Come on, lift it up. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, lift it up.
Those hands out and say, Lord, I'm going to ask that you use these hands. Lord, I'm going to ask that you use my lips. Lord, I'm going to ask that you use my feet and my life. I am a witness of the Most High God with the seal of the Spirit working in my life. I belong to Jesus. Let there be that clear line. Let it not be wavering in any way. Let it not be somehow grayed and blurred. Lord, let it be clear. We have been marked with the seal of the Spirit, embossed with the holiness of God. We're not to grieve the Holy Spirit. We are to work with and under the Spirit's mantle and leadership in our lives, giving us direction, giving us power, giving us anointing, giving us wisdom, guidance and direction in all that we do. Lord, lay your hands upon each and every one, Lord, of your children. Father, I pray, let that seal be witnessed. Let that seal be seen. Let that seal be realized with assurance that we are the children of God, waiting and yearning for so much more. Father, give us a beautiful, wonderful day and a great week. Keep us strong in the Lord and in the power of your might. We pray these things in Jesus' name. And everyone said, God bless you. Give Jesus a hand clap. Give the Father a hand clap.